Good evening. I'm Philip Sharp, president of AAAS and an institute professor at MIT. And it's a great honor to introduce Sue Lindquist this evening for her lecture, From Yeast Cells to Patient Neurons. Sue is a pioneer in taking some of the most fundamental processes in a cell, how a protein folds, and relating it to human neurological problems, and in some cases, contributing to possible therapies of that condition. She's a professor at MIT, a member of the Whitehead Institute, and she was director of the Institute from 2001 to 2004. And she's also a Howard Hughes medical investigator. That means she gets a lot of money from Howard Hughes. Before she came to MIT, in fact, she established her career here at the University of Chicago. And in fact, she grew up in the University of Chicago and did her undergraduate work downstate at the Champaign-Urbana at the University of Illinois there. She's a very distinguished scientist, has been elected to the American Academy of Science, the National Academy of Science, the Institution of Medicine, and the American Philosophical Society. And that's the trifecta in terms of societies for a US scientist to be part of. She's won many honors and medals. I won't go through all of them. I'll just mention a few. She's won the Mendel Medal from the Genetics Society, the Delbruck Medal, and the US National Medal of Science. She's been involved in biotech and translating her science into therapeutics. And she will, I'm sure, tell us something about all of this evening. So join me in welcoming Sue Lindquist for our talk tonight.
Thank you, Paul. Well, thank you. Thank you all for being here on a Sunday night. I've got quite a meandering story to tell you, which is going to end up on neurodegenerative diseases. And can I have the first slide, please? It's going to start out talking about proteins and protein folding, but it's going to end up telling you about how we can use these organisms over here. These are yeast cells to potentially provide some solutions to really dastardly diseases that strike these people over here. And it all actually relates to the following. We have had a triumph of science in terms of the increased lifespan of mankind in just the last couple of hundred years. It's quite an extraordinary thing. And that has come about due to successes of many of the types of sciences that have been talked about at this meeting. Public health, sanitation, refrigeration, engineering, surgery, anesthesia, antibiotics, vaccines. It's really quite remarkable. Statins, things like Lipitor, which are saving us from cardiovascular disease. But the other way of looking at longevity is as a road to ruin, because as we are curing these diseases and increasing man's lifespan, it means that we are more and more likely to become subject to neurodegenerative diseases. And for neurodegenerative diseases, right now, there's no exit. There are no effective therapies. And the change in the incidence of various diseases and the rise of neurodegenerative disease has become quite stark and sudden, so that if you look just from the changes from 2000 to 2008, and you look at we've many fewer deaths from HIV, from heart disease, breast cancer, somewhat of a decrease in deaths, stroke. But there's been a 66% increase in the number of people who've died of Alzheimer's disease. The costs are absolutely staggering. They run to about $200 billion a year, and that's one quarter of our health budget, not just for Alzheimer's disease, but for all of the neurodegenerative diseases of aging, like Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, Huntington's, ALS, many others. And they take currently 5% of the GDP. It will triple with our increase in lifespan by the year 2050. And that's enough to tell you it's simply unsustainable. We've got to find a solution to this. And of course, we can't even begin to calculate the personal costs of these diseases to both the individuals who are stricken by them and the families. So, as I mentioned, I'm going to tell you a story that meanders around to talk about how protein folding affects a lot of our biology and affects many different diseases of man. In fact, it's the single largest cause of disease in mankind. And I'll mention a few different things about the diseases that are caused by protein folding problems, but I'll then concentrate it at the end of my talk on how they contribute to these dreadful neurodegenerative diseases. So this story we actually think holds some promise. And as I mentioned, it starts with proteins. And the first thing for you to know is that proteins are us. So you may think about proteins as being food, or especially bodybuilding food. But they're really food for a very particular reason, and that is just about everything in us that does anything interesting is made of protein. And we can't make all those component parts ourselves. So we have to eat protein and then break it up all up into little bitty amino acids and string all those amino acids back together to make our own versions of protein. And as I said, proteins do just about everything. If you can imagine, you're looking at a pear tree and you're seeing this beautiful yellow ripe pear on that tree. The light that strikes your eyes is striking a protein in your eye, and it's converting its conformation, sending a signal to the brain, and that relay signal to the brain is all conveyed by proteins. And then as you reach to pluck that pear, that's of course all using the muscles of your arm. And the energy for moving your muscles of your arm is coming from a bunch of other proteins. And then as you smell that pear, it smells so good, you've got chemical receptors inside of your nose, and those are proteins. And as you bite and chew that apple and it goes, that pear rather, and it goes down into your stomach, and the enzymes start digesting it, those are all proteins too. So proteins are us. How do we get proteins? Proteins are all encoded by DNA. And I have an analogy to show you about this DNA code, because the DNA code is a very long, linear, coiled up piece of information. And I don't know how many of you remember these things, these cassette tapes. My youngest daughter can kind of barely remember what this is, but I think that since I can probably still use this. So the code doesn't look particularly interesting. Looks very simple and blah, but the complexity of what that encodes is simply staggering. Anyway, you get the idea. What that's happening in each of our cells of our body, we have that code, that very complex code, and different cells in our body are using different pieces of it, and they're using the different pieces of it that are coding for different proteins to create every individual cell in our body. with different combinations of those proteins. And so the DNA is coding for proteins. And when it codes for proteins, those proteins are also linear. They're like the initial code of the DNA. They reflect that code, and they're long linear strings of amino acids. The key to the protein folding problem, and the key to the problem that plays out into so many different human diseases, is that those proteins have to fold. So they don't look like that. They don't do anything when they look like that. They have to fold up into these incredibly complicated shapes. And they have to get those shapes exactly right. If there's just one little bad thing in one of the proteins out of the thousands of proteins in your body that is wrong in that fold, that can cause cystic fibrosis. That's because that protein doesn't function properly. But when proteins aren't folded properly, it's not only that you can sometimes lose an important function that they have. Those proteins can sometimes go off as renegades and run amok and do terrible things. And in fact, that's responsible for most of the cancers that we suffer from, mutated proteins that are causing cells to grow when they shouldn't be growing. And it's also responsible for all of the neurodegenerative diseases. Now, in thinking about the protein folding problem, a really good analogy, and the complexity of this problem, a really good analogy is to think of, again, music and the code for music, and think about the sheets of metal that are going to have to fold up to make a musical instrument. Very complex musical instrument. And when it's done right, it plays beautiful music. But when you get the fold a little wrong, it's not so great. And this can be played out again and again. Every protein having its own very particular shape, its own very particular function to perform. And when it's not quite folded properly, that truly is not unlike the problem of protein folding. So all of these different instruments, these different proteins have to be folded properly, and they have to work together. And as I say, they all have to work together. If there's just one bad musical instrument in the bunch, it can really be a disaster. Now, to show you what proteins look like when they're going about their business in the cell, I've borrowed a movie from The Inner Life of the Cell. It's an animation by Alan Veal and Robert Liu, executed by John Lieber. And it's really quite terrific, I think. So first, we're going to be seeing some blood cells moving through the bloodstream. And then we're going to be seeing a white blood cell moving along and attaching to another cell. And those are proteins. And this is an oily substance. It's a lipid membrane that separates the cell from the outside and separates different compartments of the cell, that oily stuff. And those are proteins moving around on it. These are proteins that are part of the structural organization of the cell. And there are many different structural organizers in the cell. These are very important proteins from yeast to neurons. And they're built up in very specific ways with exquisite control. You get the highway when you want that highway. It serves as both structural component and as a highway. It's cut and taken apart at the proper time. There's another one of these cytoskeletal elements that serves as another highway. It's cut, it's assembled and disassembled in very precise ways. And this is a really amazing thing. Oh, by the way, I do need to tell you that these are real, these movies are real. This isn't fantasy. They're done from extremely precise knowledge of what those proteins look like from X-ray crystallography. So what this particular protein is, I do want to point out to you, this is one of those structural highway systems in this cell. And this is a very specialized protein that is moving a huge package of goods from one side of the cell to the other. And this is going to turn out to be very important in neurodegenerative diseases because these kinds of vesicles are involved in carrying neurotransmitters that our neurons release to tell other neurons to do other things. And when, I'm not going to not have slide for the rest of this very short little bit, but what happens is those blobs, once they're made and they're delivered to the right place, and I'm not showing you all the different control elements that work these gears, but they move into different compartments, fuse with different compartments, they get modified and changed in those compartments, and then they move out away from those compartments, they get back onto the cytoskeleton, they start moving outside the cell, and then they join the surface of the cell, and everything is, this is what we call secretion. So I want you to remember that movie, because it really gives a beautiful illustration, I think, of all the many extraordinary things that proteins do, and that proteins are doing in very, very conserved ways, from a yeast cell to a nerve cell. So the problem with protein folding, in addition to the fact that these things are very precise, complicated structures, is that they have to do this, they have to fold these long things, have to fold that way and get it right in this incredibly crowded environment. And this wonderful picture illustration by David Goodsell is a very good, very accurate depiction of the organization of proteins in a cell. One aspect of it that's not very good, that doesn't really convey realistically what's going on in the cell, is that the proteins are not static. They're moving around like crazy. They're bumping into each other constantly. And this seems like a kind of a crazy thing to do, because you can imagine how difficult it is for a protein that's made as a long string of amino acids to fold up even if things weren't moving around. But with things moving around, it's pretty darn hard. Of course, cells wouldn't do that if there wasn't a really great benefit to it. The movement of things around the cell and the energy that these proteins have makes all kinds of life processes possible that would not be possible without that kind of energy and movement. But it really does make this one problem of getting cells folded a difficult one. And so to give you kind of a vivid image of what the protein folding problem is like in a living cell, I'm going to first tell you that it's proteins swimming about the cell, going about their business. Unlike that gorgeous movie that you saw, I told you that it was extremely accurate. And believe me, it is extremely accurate. There's one way in which it's not accurate. It's not crowded, and it's not chaotic. So it's not like Esther Williams and her mermaids. It's much more like the wave pool in the Summerland Amusement Park in Tokyo on a really hot summer day. Now, just imagine if a little bit more kinetic energy was put into that system, for example, with a heat treatment, which I'm going to show you some things about in a moment, or if some of the water was being withdrawn, but there was just as much energy, or if certain individuals in that pool had broken legs. I mean, disaster would ensue in a hurry, right? And that's really what life is like. Proteins are crowded, they're moving around like crazy, and bad things can happen when they misfold. So how do we come to understand that this really is a big problem? Well, a lot of it started with something very simple, and that was the heat shock response. So what we have here are two petri dishes of yeast cells. They form colonies. And this was an experiment in which we took cells and grew them at 25 degrees. And one aliquot of the cells we took out and we put directly in hot water. So like the hot water coming out of your tap when you've had it running for a few minutes. And the other cells, these over here, got that same treatment. The difference was that those cells first got a little chance to get used to it by giving them an intermediate temperature of about 39 degrees centigrade, warm water, but not hot. And they then got that high temperature heat shock, but they were ready, and they were fine. Same thing happens with Arabidopsis seedlings, direct heat shock versus a conditioning pretreatment. These are human cells in culture, direct heat shock versus a conditioning heat pretreatment. Birds do it, bees do it, educated fleas do it. Every organism on this planet does this. And you yourself actually have a very vivid understanding, I am 100% sure, of what happens when you apply heat to proteins. Right? That's literally denatured or aggregated misfolded protein. And it's what's happening, for example, in cancers. For some cancers, it's what's happening in the brain. Of course, it's not turned into a solid mass. Just a smallish percent of those proteins are misfolded in that way. But it's enough to wreck disaster. So what are the solutions? Well, it turns out that these solutions to this protein folding problem is as old as life itself. And the solutions to this problem are very ancient. And this is illustrated right here with a yeast cell, what it's doing. So what we've done is we've taken the proteins that the cell is making, and we've spread them out in an electric field. And each little bar is a different protein. And it's just a very quick way of getting a quick snapshot of what the cell is doing, what proteins it's making. And you can see that at the room temperature here, they're making a bunch of proteins. And then during those conditioning treatments, when they're getting ready for something's not going well, they're doing an emergency response and they're making new proteins. And these are called heat shock proteins. They're called heat shock proteins simply because we first discovered them with heat, but it turns out they're induced by many, many stresses. Lack of oxygen or too much oxygen or acidic pH or basic pH or too little water or too much water sometimes. Anyway, many, many different stresses. And they protect against many, many different stresses. So they're really representing a very, very broadly used survival mechanism. And it turns out that these proteins, this response, this fundamental response that's common to all organisms, in a sense, not surprisingly, it's such a fundamental, deeply rooted response, plays out in all sorts of ways in human disease. It plays out in infectious disease. It plays out in cancer biology. And it plays out in neurodegenerative disease. So I'm going to only show you one slide about infectious disease so you get an idea of what I'm talking about. And we're working on some of those aspects of the problem, but I'm mostly going to tell you a little bit more about some cancer biology aspects that are involved with that misfolding, and then I'll finish with what we're doing with neurodegenerative disease. So here we have a mosquito biting someone. The mosquito is infected with a malaria parasite, and when that parasite suddenly enters into a human body, there's a big change in temperature from a mosquito to the human body. That's the first element of heat shock that plays out in this infection. The second one is that our cells mount a fever because we know those organisms are vulnerable to heat, so we try to kill them by heating them. It's pretty hard on us, too, but that's the basic mechanism and reason for fever. So one might imagine that if you were able to stop some aspects of that heat shock response in that parasite, and this applies to fungi and many, many other parasites as well, you might be able to do something that would help to stop that organism from being able to grow in us. Now, when it comes to cancer and neurodegeneration, unfortunately, we're a little bit between a rock and a hard place. Because with cancer, it turns out that our cancer cells are using that survival response. They're using that survival response to thrive and grow in us and, in effect, kill us. And on the other hand, our brains, which are accumulating these misfolded proteins in neurodegenerative diseases, should be using that survival response and to help them cope with this protein folding stress, these stresses that are going to cause proteins to lose their shape, and they're not doing it. So There's one particular protein I want to tell you just a little bit about that is playing a very central role in balancing, the balancing act between neurodegeneration and cancer. And this is a protein called HSF, and I've portrayed him here as the strong man in the middle of this tightrope. That's a master regulator of the heat shock response. What I mean by that is it's a protein that goes around to different parts of the DNA and turns on all of those heat shock proteins and many, many other proteins that I didn't even bother to name to you, but they're also part of that stress response. And it's not doing it quite properly in cancer, and it's not doing it quite properly in neurodegeneration, and it is doing it in cancer. So how can we make use of this knowledge about this master regulator of the heat shock response? I actually think we can make use of it in cancer potentially, because if we could stop, even if we were to find an agent that would stop all of these different cancers from using the heat shock response, using that heat shock master regulator, survival response, we might be able to use that as part of our armamentarium in fighting cancer. I don't think that would be a problem for neurodegeneration because cancer treatments are generally of short duration, and our normal cells don't need that response. It's really only with stress. I don't, on the other hand, think that it's a good idea for neurodegeneration to turn it back on in our nerve cells, because we'd have to have it on all the time. Neurodegenerative diseases last for years, and turning on that response might make it more likely for cancers to arise and take advantage of it. So I'll tell you what we're doing with regard to cancer and neurodegeneration in the rest of my talk. So the heat shock survival response, you can actually follow this fairly easily in cells by simply making an antibody against that master regulator. This master regulator is a protein itself. It's just like the conductor of the orchestra, really. And it's telling when the heat shock proteins to come in at this time. And in these slides, that master regulator is stained with brown. This is a really interesting tissue section here because it's the border between normal cells and the tumor cells. And you can see that in normal cells, they're not using that survival response. That transcriptional regulator, that master regulator, is sitting out in the cytoplasm of the cell and it's not doing anything. But in the tumor, it's in the nucleus, which is the command central of the cell, and it's turning on that response and it's helping those cells survive. And that's breast cancer. That's pancreatic cancer. That's colon cancer. And that's lung cancer. So across all kinds of cancers, we've stained thousands of them now. We've not seen a single cancer type in which this does not happen. So then how do we know that it really matters? Well, actually, it turns out there's a very interesting way to go about investigating that. And that involves following patients and taking advantage of some really prescient studies that were set up many, many years ago. So for example, there is a study called the Nurses' Health Study. And it was started by National Cancer Institute, National Institute of Health, about 35 years ago. And it takes advantage of the fact that nurses are also extremely good patients. They're very reliable. And when they agreed to start as part of this study, when they were very healthy women, they agreed that if they were to get breast cancer during their lifetime, that biopsy could be taken, and that they would come back year after year to report on how they're doing, and that tissue could be actually saved for posterity and used for medical study. So what we were able to do was to go back to this archive, years old archive, and take the samples that were taken on biopsy when these women were first diagnosed, and we stained them for the heat shock response, and many of those tumors, even when they were really early tumors, they had very strong heat shock response. Some had only an intermediate one, and some had none. And then we decoded all that stuff, and we looked to see how those women had done over the years. And it turned out that the women who had a very strong heat shock response in those cancers did not do well. The women who did not have a heat shock response, sorry, I'm not supposed to be using that pointer, I'm supposed to be using this pointer. The black line is the women whose tumors, whether they were early or late stage tumors, were not mounting this, using the survival response. So does it matter? Yes, it does matter. And we have actually done this now with breast, lung, and colon cancer. And so we wonder what we can, now we have this knowledge, what we can do. And we're encouraged by some studies we've been doing in mice, because we've made mice that genetically are incapable of mounting that survival response. Now, it turns out that they don't survive heat very well, they don't survive strokes very well, they don't survive heart attacks very well. But these are mice, the normal mice with a normal survival response that have been treated in a way that will bring out tumors on them, and those mice all died. And the matching mice, nothing different about them except for the fact that they don't have that master regulator and they can't turn on that survival response. They're doing very well. It's because the cancer cells can't take advantage of that response. So we're hoping that we might be able to use this in a few different ways. We might be able to use it diagnostically. You might have heard on the news recently that there's a big controversy about screening for breast cancer because it hasn't really moved the dial very much. And many women wind up getting tumors taken out, maybe that didn't need to be taken out. There are all kinds of morbidities associated with that. It's a very controversial subject, and I don't want to opine on it. But we think that this might be one tool for being able to look at an early cancer and see which ones are more likely to progress and should be treated more aggressively. We haven't proven that yet, but it's looking pretty interesting. We also really want to know how it's controlled in cancer, because I showed you those normal cells right next to the tumor. They're not mounting a heat shock response. Why are the cancer cells turning it on? What is turning it on in those cancer cells? Can we interfere with those signals? And if we could, might we be able to use that therapeutically? I would never expect that we'd be able to use that to cure cancers, but I think it would be a wonderful, broadly applicable adjunct therapy to use in many different cancers in conjunction with other therapeutics that are more targeted. So it's just a beginning. Here's, for example, a couple of papers that we published this year. But I want to also tell you that there are many, many labs using many, many other approaches. They're studying common aspects of the metabolism of cancers and trying to knock down cancers that way. They're studying immunology and trying to instruct our own immune defenses to get rid of them more effectively. And so my lab is just one part of a much, much, much broader effort around the world where people are really beginning to make headway, as I mentioned, in these diseases. So I'm going to finish with telling you about the protein folding diseases of the brain. This is a section of a normal brain and a section of an Alzheimer's brain. That was actually taken by one of the neurologists in my laboratory. He works at MGH. And it turns out, as I mentioned, a very large part of our healthcare budget is going to the treatment of the demented. We, as I mentioned, this doesn't take account the personal funding and the care and the hardship. It's something we really have to do something about. So here are the kinds of diseases I'm talking to you about. In each of these diseases, Alzheimer's disease, prion diseases, frontal temporal dementias, Lewy body dementias, Parkinson's disease, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, they're all associated in different parts of the brain with particular proteins misfolding and going bad and doing bad things. And there is not a single one of these diseases for which we have a treatment that's aimed at stopping the underlying precipitating early events in the disease. We do have some things that can treat symptoms, but we don't have anything that's getting at the fundamental underlying mechanism. The only exception to that being a protein called TTR, which causes a very rare neuropathy, and it was recently approved as a drug in Europe. And as Phil was mentioning, I was involved in a biotech company that developed that. But that's a very small step. We've got a much bigger problem ahead of us. So the mechanism actually we had used to solve the problem of TTR, and that was Jeff Kelly's really pioneering work. It's a chemist that I paired up with. That turns out it's not going to, the particular trick we use there is not going to work with these other diseases. So it's really, really time to think outside the box, because there has been a lot of work on neurodegeneration for a long period of time, and we're not making any headway on it. And believe me, that's not because people haven't been working really hard and haven't had really good ideas. But we think that we need to start thinking outside the box here. And as you might have imagined from the things I said earlier, that box I'm trying to think outside of is the normal ways of studying neurodegenerative diseases in organisms that have brains. That makes sense, of course, to study them in organisms that have brains. But remember what I was saying about the relationships between yeast and animals. If you look at the evolution of life, the tree of the evolution of life, and look at just where it is that animals and fungi diverged from the rest of life. All along here, this whole long pathway, a billion years or so, more than a billion years of evolution, these are all what we call eukaryotic cells, or the higher organisms. The organisms in which proteins moving about and being carried on vesicles and doing the kinds of things I showed you in that beautiful movie, Inner Life of a Cell, all of those novelties were developed along this arm of the pathway. And then these guys split off from each other. And of course, animals have many, many, many novelties that the yeast cells don't have. But that underlying architecture is the same. And remember I told you about those proteins writing, those structural elements being constructed and deconstructed and extraordinary precision in their regulation in the cell. And those big, big blobs of things that are being moved from one end of the cell to the other. And then that secretion that occurs, all of that takes place in a yeast cell. It takes place in a nerve cell. And it's done in exactly the same way. Of course, what the yeast cells secrete and what the nerve cells secrete is different. The yeast cells are secreting cell wall material. The neurons are secreting neurotransmitters, like dopamine, for example. But neurons, as complicated and beautiful as they are, did not reinvent the whole system. They used this ancient system that had evolved earlier. They just used it to transport different things. So we got the idea that we might be able to use yeast cells as sort of living test tubes to study protein folding and trafficking problems. The reason being that yeast cells are cheap and easy and fast to grow. And more than that, it turns out that brewers wanted to make better beer about 150 years ago. And so they started working on yeast cells genetically. And they made better and better beer. And as they did, they learned how to manipulate this organism in ways that it's just quite extraordinary, because by just plain good fortune, that organism has certain properties of genetics that it's like a gift from God in terms of doing science. So they're fast, easy, and there's no other organism on the planet that we can manipulate like we can manipulate these. So the idea would be to coax out of them some properties of this trafficking network and this highway and the protein folding that might apply to neurodegenerative diseases. And I can tell you that when we first suggested this, it was brutal. People were not very willing to accept this idea. Very hard to get funding for it, very hard to get people to sit in an audience and listen to it. But I'd been working on these organisms for a long time, and I was convinced that there was something to it. And I don't, again, mean to say that people were being mean. It was just perfectly natural that they would think that it was crazy, because when you come from the standpoint of studying neurobiology, what you think about with a neuron, a brain cell, is the glory of its connectivity. This long connected cell that's sending messages from one end of the brain to the other end of the brain, just extraordinary cells. And this connectivity is so intrinsic to everything we think about, the circuits of the brain, that it would seem naturally kind of crazy to study a neurodegenerative disease process in a yeast cell. The only reason I thought about it was because I've been working on yeast for a long time, and I know that all of these aspects of the general organization of the cell is the same, that they have unparalleled genetics. They're remarkably robust for high throughput screening, about which I'll tell you in a second. And as I mentioned, the basic pathways that are involved in protein folding and trafficking are the same. And moreover, if you look at some of the biggest blockbuster drugs we have on the market, they work just as well in a yeast cell as they do in a nerve cell. Now, they weren't discovered in yeast cells because no one thought to look for them there. But believe me, we could have discovered them in yeast cells. And in fact, when it comes to, for example, inhibiting a very important enzyme called HMG-CoA reductase, we don't even bother with genetics in yeast anymore. We use the statins. Lipitor, simvastatin, they all work just fine in yeast. So it's not unreasonable to think that we might not only be able to use yeast genetics to understand some of the genes that are involved in some of these fundamental pathologies, we might also even be able to use them to find some compounds that might make a difference. So what we did was we set up a series of yeast strains in which we imported these different proteins, those proteins that I showed you were in big globs in the brains of those people that had Alzheimer's disease, different globs of aggregated protein in different diseases. We took those different proteins and we put them into the gene, into a yeast cell, and told the yeast cell to make that protein. And we set up a series of models here in which the cells are spotted in serial dilutions along the plate. And we can control the time when those proteins are produced or not produced by giving them a specific sugar. Yeast cells love sugar. That's why we love yeast cells, because they make beer and alcohol for us, and bread, too, by gobbling up sugars. So they're very sensitive to sugars. And in one type of sugar, they're all the same. They're not making that protein. But we've rigged it up such that when they're given this one sugar called galactose, they start to turn on that protein. And now you can see that these cells have different amounts of that protein, and they're not growing too well. So these are cells that are expressing a protein called alpha-synuclein. That's a protein that's involved in several different neurodegenerative diseases. Or A-beta, involved in Alzheimer's. TDP-43, involved in both frontal temporal dementia and ALS. And Huntington protein. And so we set them up such that they would make an amount of protein that would make them sick. And then they're all looking sick, and this could have been really a stupid thing to do because they could have all been getting sick just for non-specific protein aggregation problems. But that's not what happened. What turns out is that each of those cells gets sick in a very special, very different way that's actually reflective of some of the biology of when that happens when they misfold in a human nerve cell. And just to show you one example of a trait that occurs that's very, very specific, all of these cells are dying. It's only in these cells that if we stain for proteins that have been nitrated, you've heard of perhaps reactive oxygen species. They're reactive radicals that go about and attach to proteins and do bad things. There are also reactive nitrogen species that do the same things. And only in our alpha-synuclein model do we see massive amounts of reactive nitrogen species, and you're going to see that playing out in just a moment. So actually, we have very unique pathologies, and they have unique genetic modifiers and unique genetic chemical modifiers. And we've found, amongst the ones that we've tested so far, quite remarkably, the ones that we find that work in yeast, a fairly substantial fraction of them are working to rescue neurons, brain cells from the same proteins. Now, right now, it's brain cells in a dish, but we have to start step by step. So these are the diseases in which synuclein plays a role, Parkinson's, dementia with Lewy bodies, multiple system atrophy, and neurodegeneration with brain iron accumulation. And then these blobs are just blobs of these misfolded proteins. They occur in different cell types, cause different diseases. Parkinson's disease being by far the most common, but they're all dreadful. So we started with alpha-synuclein for a very simple reason. It's a really simple little protein. It's small, and all it does that we know its basic physical properties are two things. It doesn't structure very well unless it's bound to a membrane. So it likes to bind to those oily surfaces that I showed you in that movie that proteins move around on. And when it's bound to those surfaces, it's in pretty good shape. But when it's not bound to those surfaces, it forms nasty aggregates over here. These are different types of aggregated messes. So we hook up a fluorescent marker that will shine green light, but let this protein shine green light and show us where it is. And when we express a certain amount, one or two copies, one or two genes worth of protein in these cells, does something very nice. That protein very selectively goes out to the periphery of the cell and binds to the membrane out in the periphery of the cell. And that's nice because in nerve cells, that's exactly where it is too. It's out at the ends of the neurons where those neurotransmitters are going to be secreted. But when we add just one extra copy, things start to look pretty bad. When we add a couple of extra copies, things really look bad. And that's accompanied by the fact that these cells grow normally. Those cells grow slowly. And those cells die. What was really striking about that, and it was something that got our hearts beating a little bit, was that this is unusual to have this extreme sensitivity to the amount of a normal protein that you're making. This is not a mutated protein. It's a normal protein. But that's true in human beings, too, because one of the causes of Parkinson's disease in humans is simply having you have two copies. People who have, unfortunately, one extra copy will get early onset Parkinson's disease. If they have two extra copies, they get an even more severe form. So we screen in our intermediate toxicity strain for things that will make the cells better or worse. And we screen in the really severe strain for things, in the intermediate strain, we screen for genes. And in the extreme strain, we screen for chemical compounds. Now, what the heck do I mean by screening? Well, screening is a lot like panning for gold. And what it really means is you have to go through a hell of a lot of sand and gravel, and you scoop up some more, and you scoop up some more, and it's backbreaking, and it takes days. And then, oh my gosh, is that you see some gold. Okay, so, but that doesn't really mean too much until you find it again and again and again in that same stream. Then you know you're in a place where you've struck gold. Now, you may have just hit a vein of gold, or you may have a mother lode. We don't know yet, but we think we've struck gold. So we screened 6,000 genes. We tested 6,000 genes for whether or not they'd make those cells feel any better or worse. We got out 60 genes that mattered. And we've depicted them here in just a simple cartoon as balls. And we've connected those balls because in yeast there has been so much genetics and so much protein chemistry that we know which of those balls work together in other cellular processes. So we can start to connect these things. And here's one way in which we struck one piece of gold, and that was many of those genes we were known to be involved in that secretory process, that thing that moves dopamine out of the cells in a nerve cell, moves cell wall material out in a yeast cell. So we asked, were those little vesicles being blocked? And we looked at these same cells under a much higher powered a microscope called an electron microscope. And sure enough, these little vesicles, which carry material to the outside of the cell, are getting stuck in these cells, and they're even more stuck in these cells. And that has now been corroborated by many other people in the brain and in nerve cells. Another way we've gone about seeing whether we're on the right track here is we've taken a lot of those genes that we hit. In fact, we took 6 different genes from really very different parts of the system. We tested them in 2 organisms. We tested them in a little roundworm. That's a gift to experimental science because you can see through it. Like many of you had glass fish in your aquarium when you were kids. These are glass worms. You can see through them, and you can label their neurons with green to glow green light, and here are the 4 neurons. And then we can test the related, so through DNA sequencing, we can others have figured out which yeast genes correspond to which nematode in human genes and rat genes. And so we take those genes, we take the nematode versions or the rat versions, we stick them in those organisms. And the advantage of doing something in this worm is that it's a living creature that you can test and actually look at what's happening to the nerves in real time. We do rat embryonic neurons, the same kind of tests. They're dissociated neurons, but they're closer to home. What about human neurons? Well, our first success was this gene right here. It's called YPK9. And that's because it's the yeast homologue of a gene that was just recently discovered as being mutated in people who have a particularly aggressive form of Parkinson's disease. It was not known to be connected to that alpha-synuclein protein. We connected it through our yeast cells. Moreover, because we're working in yeast, they're easy to work with, they're cheap, we're actually able to say, what's it doing in those yeast cells? And it's protecting them from manganese. And that's really interesting because there are some environmental toxins that are known to be associated with Parkinsonism. And manganese is one of those. So we've connected a genetic outlier gene in humans that wasn't known to be related to the protein I'm talking to you about. We've connected that to an environmental toxin, so we're beginning to now take that map of connections in yeast and connect them in human beings. And in fact, we haven't published this yet, but all of those other gold dots on there represent human genes that are associated with Parkinson's disease or other neurodegenerative diseases that have Parkinsonian features. So I think in this particular case, at least, we actually have started to strike gold. What about chemical compounds? We've also done chemical library screens. We have, the idea was, might we find compounds that could fix more than one problem? That's why there's so many things going wrong when the pathology really gets bad. We wanted to start with that strain that was frankly dying, and see if we could save that cell, thinking, well, maybe that would hit some node in the pathology that would matter a lot. And the reason we wanted to screen the yeast cells, we simply screened for what would make them better, thinking that, well, we could go back to yeast with genetics and find the target. The reason being that in terms of successful drugs, many more successful drugs have come from biological screens, screens in which you pan through 500,000 compounds and you look for something that'll revert a cancer cell back to normal. But the trouble is in using those compounds is you don't know what the heck they're doing. It's very hard to understand what the compound is doing. So instead, pharmaceutical companies overwhelmingly use what are called target-based screens. That is, they isolate the individual protein. The problem there, and look for things that will affect that protein, the problem there is it's sometimes hard to get those compounds into the cell. Those compounds will sometimes hit other things. They'll sometimes cause toxicities, et cetera. So we thought we had this great opportunity with yeast because we can screen it for compounds very easily. Just throw a little bit of compound into hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of dishes, little wells that are growing these cells. And we screened through 550,000 compounds. This is something that would have been impossible to do with nerve cells. We simply screened for things that would make them better. We only have a few dissected so far, but those ameliorate all those pathologies that I told you about, pathologies that I haven't told you about. And very excitingly, the ones we've looked at least, work in nematode, they work in the rat, and they work in human neurons too. So the final little segment here is going to be about human neurons and what we do. You may have heard about the promise of human iPS cells, induced pluripotent stem cells. And what those cells are is you identify a patient who's got a genetic mutation that gives them a particular disease, like Parkinson's disease. You take a little bit of skin cells from them, a biopsy. You grow those cells in a tissue culture dish, and you treat them in such a way that they'll de-differentiate away from skin and become a sort of embryonic-like cell. And then you treat them with a whole bunch of other factors, and you can get them to develop into neurons in a culture dish. Now, a real triumph of this technology in recent years has been that you know what the mutation is. There have been developed, really just in the last few years, methods for going into a human genome and cutting out the specific mutation that's causing that disease and correcting it surgically. And we've done that. So we have these absolutely genetically identical cells, except for one nucleotide out of the billions of nucleotides in the DNA is different. That means they're absolutely perfectly controlled for each other. The problem is that they look the same. They look exactly the same. And when you think about it was disappointing at first, but when you think about it, these are diseases that strike people after 60 or 70 years of age. And it's pretty unlikely that you're going to see a difference in cell death in a dish after 8 to 12 weeks of neuronal differentiation. So how do we find something about their biology? Well, long before the cells start to die, we start looking at those processes of trafficking proteins around the cell. We start looking at their mitochondria. We start looking at the release of reactive nitrogen species. And sure enough, we can detect those phenotypes in the patient neurons, but not in the mutant-corrected neurons. So that tells you that those biological traits, those things that were going wrong in those yeast cells and are going wrong in the patient neurons, are not just going wrong in the patient neurons, but they're specifically due to the mutations that are causing the disease. So we have a compound that we've taken all the way from rescuing yeast phenotypes, and it rescues multiple phenotypes, to rescuing those same phenotypes in neurons, and it rescues multiple phenotypes in neurons. I'm not going to take you through all of them. The problem now is, what the heck does it do? How is it working? Awfully hard to get something approved by the FDA unless you know what it's going to do, especially if it's going to ever lead to be long-term treatment. So the way we did that was to take advantage of yeast genetics and a really Herculean effort. We screened for genes that would make things better or worse in multiple, multiple different ways and multiple different formats, and I won't tell you all about it, but this really is what's something that they call the awesome power of yeast genetics. And it was only because we could approach all of these different screens and use them in many different ways that we were able to zero in on the target. And what's the target? It's a very highly conserved protein. That's just a cartoon diagram of the different domains in the protein, and it has the same exact domains in the yeast cell and in the human cell. It's a class of protein that has been very difficult to characterize before. It's very difficult to take it out of a cell and get it to work right, because it works with all kinds of other proteins. So screening for a compound that would hit this, we would never have been able to do it. We had to do it in a living cell. And it demonstrates the power of these kinds of biological screens and the power of chemical genetics, because it identified a protein for us that was an absolute node in determining the pathology of that protein that we hadn't yet found from simple genetics, because it affects many proteins. So we're pursuing the same strategy with Alzheimer's disease. We've created a model that makes this a beta protein, the protein that forms plaques in Alzheimer's disease and distributes throughout the cell. And we know we're beginning to hit gold with this model too, because there, out of 6,000 genes in the yeast genome, there are only a small number that will correct that pathology. And when you look at whether those genes are broken in people who have Alzheimer's disease, actually it's now 5 out of the 12 or so genes that are known to be associated with Alzheimer's disease that we have correspondence with in our yeast cells for A-beta. And we've also screened through 550,000 compounds and have compounds that correct. So these are those references. And that's all I'm going to have to say. This is early research. We don't know if it's going to work. I think it will. But I want to also emphasize that it's really only one sort of arsenal. These diseases are so, so difficult. We really need to take every different kind of approach we can take and think out of the box in a variety of different ways. So I want to thank you. And also I want to just thank, I'm going to go through this very quickly and not name everybody, but I have had the extraordinary good fortune to have a remarkable, gifted group of young people working in my laboratory. And these are the people who made those major discoveries. Some wonderful, wonderful colleagues that we've collaborated with. Science, if you're going to do it fast and efficiently nowadays, means you've got to collaborate with other people who are experts in things you're not. All of these people have been absolutely instrumental. And then, of course, there's our yeast cells, which are the real star of the show. I love dogs, but I think yeast are man's best friend. Beer, bread, wine, and circuses, and I mean molecular biology circuses. So I want to thank yeast, and I want to thank all of you. Bye-bye.